For this video, we'll describe two things. One, we'll go into a little bit more detail about some untraditional, non-traditional acidic cations. And then we'll introduce a new equation that we need to do, that we'll need to use in order to solve for the pH of salt solutions. At the end of the previous video, I gave you aluminum chloride as an example, but I asked you not to write the hydrolysis equation for it. And the reason for that is because it is a very complicated equation. We can still predict whether aluminum chloride would be acidic, basic, or neutral. And again, we can do that by labeling our ions. So of course, the chloride we know would be neutral. Notice the 3 is just from the stoichiometry here. And aluminum we know is acidic because, remember, for cations, the labels for those are either neutral or acidic. Cations can never be basic. Well, it's not, aluminum is not neutral because it's not one of our 8 neutral cations, and so therefore it must be acidic. And it turns out that all of our relatively small, if you remember your radius trends in the periodic table, higher up on the periodic table is smaller, small with a kind of high charge, so +3 or so, all of these cations will act as acids. And so the most common list is here of aluminum, chromium, iron, and bismuth. So the hydrolysis equation is shown here on our second bullet. Remember that when salts dissolve in water, going down to the picture at the bottom, here's our aluminum ion. Remember that water molecules surround each ion in a salt to pull it off of the crystal structure. And so here is aluminum in the middle, and it is surrounded by our 6 water molecules. So that's the aluminum, dissociated aluminum ion floating around in water. The same thing would happen with chloride. It also has 6 water molecules around it in the hydration sphere. So water is neutral. This charge here comes purely from the aluminum ion. But then this is floating around in water. And because aluminum has this +3 charge on it, it can actually draw the electrons in these shared pairs more closely to it. That's where the high charge comes from, or is important. And so notice in this top water molecule, the electrons are shifted so much toward aluminum that this hydrogen that was here in water actually popped off onto our water molecule to produce hydronium. And so notice what's left over. We still have 5 intact water molecules, and then we get that 1 hydroxide, which drops our charge down by 1. And so predicting this product is not something I'm going to ask you to do in this class. So our second goal in this video is to introduce a new equation that we'll need to use when we calculate the pH of salts. And it has to do with the relationship between Ka and Kb values for a conjugate acid-base pair. So looking at an example like hydrofluoric acid, we know this is a weak acid, and we know that because that's a weak acid, it produces hydronium, would have a Ka expression. We also know that its conjugate base of fluoride will act as a base in water to produce hydroxide and would have a Kb expression. Now, 2 things we can do here. One is we can add our equations together. And this is where we cross out things that are the same on both sides, cancel those out. And so this equation leaves us with 2 water molecules that will form hydronium and hydroxide. The other thing we can do in here is to write our Ka and Kb expressions. So again, from the first equation, we have our Ka expression, products over reactants. From our second equation, we have our Kb expression, again, products over reactants. And if you remember from chapter 13, whenever we add equations together, we are now going to modify our new equilibrium expression and constant, and we do that by multiplying our two k values. Right, so we've essentially added equations 1 and 2 together, and so we're going to multiply those two k values. So in other words, I'm going to multiply my ka times my kb. So I'm multiplying this expression on the left for Ka times my expression on the right for Kb. Recognize when I do that, again, my fluoride cancels out, my HF cancels out, and notice that what's left is simply the product of hydronium times hydroxide, which should look really familiar as Kw. So net result of all of this is for a given conjugate acid base pair, the Ka of the acid times the Kb of the conjugate base would result in Kw. Remember, Kw is a numerical constant. Also, it's on your equation sheet, 1.0 times 10 to the minus 14. So we're still assuming we're at 25 degrees Celsius. And just to catch up in the slides, here we have all of this information, and here is our net result. So we'll end with a couple of practice calculations. So how this would work out, let's say we have a salt that contains chloride ion, and I would need to use a Kb here because this is a conjugate base. I can never look up the Kb or Ka of ions. So if you're ever working with an ion, chloride, fluoride, here we have methyl ammonium or just ammonium, anything that's an ion, we have to calculate the K value. Well, I can look up the original K value of the substance that gave me that ion and then use my Kw equation to convert it. Sorry, and in this one, I want to calculate Kb of chloride. I'm just writing the substance in parentheses after to track what I'm using. And so, of course, my setup here is going to be the Kw divided by the Ka of HCl. And again, we can use our rules of exponents to estimate. Kw is 1.0 times 10 to the minus 14. HCl is 1.3 times 10 to the 6th, by the way, confirming that that's a strong acid. And so remember our rules of exponents. We subtract the exponents and watch your signs. So we have a negative 14 minus a 6. So we predict an exponent of about a minus 20. Because our numerator is smaller, we're going to get dropped down by 1. So this ends up being a 7.7 times 10 to the minus 21. Which helps to confirm how weak a base chloride is. Just for comparison's sake, we will calculate for fluoride so that we can see how relatively strong the fluoride ion is. Again, we're going to use the same setup, Kw divided by our Ka of HF. And we see here with our Ka value, we do have a weak acid. When we predict our or estimate our exponent, we're going to get a minus 10. And in this one, we actually end up getting 1.4 times 10 to the, again, it drops down by 1 because our numerator is smaller, a 10 to the minus 11. So again, recognize when we say that fluoride is a relatively strong base, it's still a really weak base. But relative to chloride, fluoride is a much stronger base. But again, it's relative, much stronger than chloride. And so I'll ask you to predict or calculate and practice with part C and D, and then example 14.8 in the textbook. The next slide in your PowerPoint slides does have the answers here to check yourself.